We're going to call this meeting to order. I want to thank all of you department chairs who have joined us this evening to answer our questions about the budget. As three of us are new board members, and this is a new process for all of us, I think you might find that we, not being as familiar with your budget, we have many questions. Having said that, I would like to, I know I particularly have a lot of questions. That doesn't mean I don't support what you're requesting or that I'm even going to recommend a change, but I do feel like I need to understand what it is that you're asking for and the academic impact for our students so that we can make the best decisions moving forward as far as the budget goes and being able to advocate for the budget that we actually put forth in the end. So I think it's really important for us to have a very clear understanding. So please be patient with particularly me, but also my other board members. We would really appreciate it. All right, so having said that, is there anyone who chooses to go first?
Well, the idea, I think there's a misnomer.
Oh, sorry.
Because I did not ask them to do presentations because having only an hour, I didn't think that.
Well, they don't have to present, but we could ask them questions.
Sure, yeah, that was the idea.
Okay, Priscilla, I'm sorry, you want public comment? Go ahead, Priscilla.
Public comment, I want to make sure all your mics are on before you start. So that I wouldn't have to interrupt during the meeting.
All right.
To tell you, thank you.
We believe that all of the mics are on, and maybe if you can't hear someone in your right mic field of vision, if you just raise your hand, then I will make note of that.
Thank you.
And I will ask the person to speak a little bit louder, and that way we can do it with the least disruption. I think I'm loud enough. Okay. All right, so do I have a volunteer who would like to allow us to ask you questions first about your budget? Okay, great, Karen, thank you. Do we have a place where, I want to make sure everyone can hear Karen when she's
speaking. Loud voice too.
All right, so does anyone have questions?
Lori has the mic. Maybe. Is that the technology budget for next year?
Do you need it?
Is it working? I don't think I need it. Can everybody hear me?
Yes.
Okay, great, thank you. Does anyone have questions about the guidance department budget that was presented from Karen Price? Justin?
Yes. On the last sheet, you said you needed 27 computers. What kind of computers do you need? Do you have any idea of the cost?
I don't have any idea of the cost. I proposed it to the technology committee for the career center because we, in the past, we've had a mobile lab, and that's what I'm looking for again. But the mobile lab, we have the computers, mostly don't work. They're very slow. As I said, most of them don't work. And we use the career center for classroom lessons. Right now, what we're doing is taking the classes to the 120 computer lab. But part of our intent is to get students familiar with the career center right from freshman year so that they see that as a resource for them as they go through.
Okay, thank you.
When you say a mobile lab, What is that? Is that like?
It's a cart.
A cart, okay.
Yes, yeah.
And is it shared right currently? Is it shared with other departments or currently it's a mobile cart that's unique to the guidance department?
It is not, it's shared.
Okay.
We use the one in the library.
Just one note here before we get too into technology or technology consultant. I couldn't make it tonight. I said we'd probably have enough questions for the folks who were here anyway. But he did say we have about 100 computers that need to be replaced over the next 2 years, just to give you some idea, about 56 next year and then 45 the following year.
Thank you.
And
do you have anything else?
No, that's okay.
Okay. Question, you were looking for money to replace the black and white laser printer in the math office? Should that be?
In the math office?
She's
It said now. Did you mean it did be guidance?
We're not looking to come to replace a computer.
No, I'm sorry. Printer.
To my knowledge, that's not part of my budget.
Okay, all right.
That's an example.
Oh, I'm sorry. Okay. I didn't understand that. Sorry. Listen.
I had that same thing, and then I realized, oh, it's an example.
Okay, great. And my other question is the new study skills course for freshmen. Can you just talk to us a little bit about that?
Sure. One of the things that the teachers have said is that freshmen coming up, because they're coming from the 6 different schools, come with varying degrees of study skills and knowledge of what study skills are. So as part of the life skills curriculum, we'd like to take that first quarter, half of the first quarter, and teach them all the same thing. Time management, how to use a planner, how to set goals, decision making. There's about 8 different areas that we would like to give them all the same instruction. Beth Foles and I are writing the curriculum. We worked on it today, and we're excited that we'll be able to start the freshmen off really with a plan for how to make high school successful.
Okay, so my question is, it sounds great, but what is the, there's a...
The line item?
Line item.
For workbooks.
Oh, okay. All right, thank you. All right, does anyone else have any questions? Okay, thank you, Karen.
Thank you.
Who would like to be available to us next? Oh, fans?
I sit in the back seat.
Yeah.
Yes, please. All right, does anyone have any questions for Vance from the Library and Media Center?
Well, I just want to weigh in, actually, on the e-reader thing. I mean, I know there's been some discussion about e-books and taking out books, and I just want to say that as a reader myself, and having been involved with the Salisbury Library, the Scoville Library in Salisbury, I understand about people wanting to take out print books rather than necessarily. I mean, there's a place for both, and from what I understand, some of the studies on it have shown that readers sort of go a third, a third, a third. They get a third of their books, they buy them, they get a third of the books out of the library, and they download a third of, you know, there's different, but it's people are not necessarily switching 100% to ebooks just because.
No, absolutely not. And also, the services available for libraries are not like
they're not good.
Buying Amazon books for us. You know, I buy a lot of books for my reader, but as far as how many books I borrow, and I know everything I've got, I still end up buying them more frequently than I borrow them on an e-reader. And if I borrow them, I usually take them out as a book. But a lot of it has to do with the availability also. There just aren't the books available to be lent as e-books that there are for us, for individuals.
Right.
To
and isn't there just a limited number that you can, like, that are lent at any one time when it's an e-book? And so.
Yeah, I mean, some publishers offered very few books at all to lend. And some of them, I mentioned one, HarperCollins doesn't actually sell you the book. It leases you the book for 26 loans, and then it disappears again. Now, honestly, 26 loans for us is quite a bit. As I said, we've only lent 35 times. And I've got over 500 lends out now in the library, in material goods. So people are not using it yet. I think this is it's an investment in the future. It is something that is evolving. I think people are learning to do it, but they don't look in the same place for them either. You know, they go into the shelves and they find a book they're interested in, they pull it out, or they see one on display. I can't display these books. So I'd have to have posters all over the place, individual titles or something. You know, so it's not something that they browse intuitively yet.
Now, do students use the Media Center primarily for research, or, I mean, you know, what are the books that they take out? Are they mostly taking out books for research? I mean, I can't imagine they have that much free time to read, or some of them might, I don't know.
I could not tell you whether more, I think that more of our loans are not for research. Most of our loans are for pleasure. But the reason I'm hesitating is because it depends on the student. It depends on the student's course load. It depends on the student's reading habits, viewing habits. We have kids who borrow books, I mean, piles of books at a time, and bring them back 2 weeks later and get more. And they're reading them. But, I mean, is that every student here? Absolutely not.
Yeah.
It's just, you know, there are some kids who are really avid readers. There are some kids who are really avid film viewers. And graphic novels, right, thank you. And I think that we have to get to a point where we understand that graphic novels and film are literature too. There are classics, there are brilliant works, there are powerful, important works there. And we want to encourage kids to read those, not necessarily because they're in the curriculum, because they're very high quality, they make them think.
Now, when you talk about weeding, which I understand you do over the summer, what kind of criteria do you use? I mean, does a book get taken out a number of times, and after it stops being taken out, you say, you know, this book is probably past
its
use?
The first thing you do is, with the program that we have, we look and see what books have not moved in 3 years, or moved perhaps once in 3 years. So we target those books. Then I go out and I pull out those books individually, and I look at the book, I look at what is in it, I look at whether it is in our guide of what high schools must have in order to be current, you know, what the minimum collection is. Because just because a book hasn't moved doesn't mean that you shouldn't have it. The fact of the matter is, it should be there. And somebody is gonna want it at some point. And you wouldn't be a well-supplied library if you didn't have it. You know, Moby Dick does not go out every possible time. But if I didn't have Moby Dick, I'd be a pretty poor librarian. So then you also decide, is this unique? Is there anything else like it? Is there anything else that can take its place? Then you also look and say, okay, has anything changed about what this book offers? The stuff I did this summer included technology. So honestly, I didn't really need books about programs for Microsoft XP. Microsoft XP for dummies. Well, that can go. That's a no-brainer. But some of them you have to look at for longer to sort of think about it. You have to do some research on the actual book. Then you wonder, okay, so if I throw this away, maybe it's in terrible condition. If I throw this away, can I get the same book again? If not, can I get another book that does the same thing, serves the same purpose? So I'm telling you, I know it sounds crazy, but for every copy I pull off, I can do anything from a minute or two to 20 minutes work, because you have to evaluate that book and then make a decision. And then I log what I'm getting rid of and what I need to do to replace it. So I do it with the iPad with me so that I can go to Amazon, see what's available, go to other booksellers and see what's available, like that.
Thank you.
You bet.
Great, thank you. Any other questions for Vance?
John, I have one. When you say get rid of a book, what is entailed there?
Take it out of the collection. So you literally delete it in the program. Then you wipe out the barcode with a magic marker. Then usually on my own time, actually, I take the books to the dump at Falls Village, where there's a large table where people go through books. And there are actually so many there now that now they don't even put them on the table, they throw them into a big box. But that's pretty much, I mean, unless it's in terrible, terrible shape, in which case I literally throw it away.
Thank you. Any other questions? Okay, thank you, Vance. Go ahead, Tom.
And don't forget, I'm covering the arts, PE, music, any of the three.
Okay. Can everyone hear him? Okay. I have a lot of questions. Sorry, hold on, I gotta find him now.
She's on order of why you're being organized.
You're right, instead of. Hope I didn't leave him on my desk.
I don't have your questions.
Right, okay. Where's the PE is the one.
Oh, I have PE.
I know PE, the PE question, some of them, there was a cost for this, and this is little, but there was a cost for CPR cards in there, and I know the cards do not cost $8 because I sit on the board of directors for the agency she gets them from.
Okay.
So they're only $6. I mean, it's not a big number, but any savings. Also, there was some repair for a, is it a, what is it called? A bicycle in the exercise room. It looks like that's also in the I think the education connection line, and it was for a different amount. Does that make sense to you, Ian? So I saw that twice. I did see it twice. One was $1,250. I saw it someplace else for $750. And I'm wondering if we're talking about the same stationary bike, and I'm unsure why it's going to fall under two departments, because I think we only need to budget for it once. So that was another question.
Andrew, do you know what line that was, so I could help you find it?
Well, I can't find my paper with my note, or I'd be happy to.
Ed Connections doesn't seem to be the right thing.
Okay, well, I know that I saw it twice, so I would have to.
Keep looking.
Okay, so that was in the, so that was that question. I did have our question.
Oh, that's the example thing again.
It is?
It's just an example.
That's all it is.
Okay, good, thank you. That's, okay. Sorry, I'm sorry that I can't get the example thing down, but I knew I saw it twice.
I will take the cards back to Jeff, and I'll talk to him about that and see if he can answer. I will tell you, as far as the PE budget is concerned, he and I sat down and talked it over, and basically he told me I put forward bare bones and operating. So if there's any discrepancies there, I'll talk to him, but he's the expert there. I kind of lean on him to put this together.
Oh, and my other question was, I saw that for some office supplies that they indicated that their vendor was Staples. Mm-hmm. And so actually this is a bigger question. When we have office supplies like that, are we submitting all our office supplies requests to one person so that we can have, you know, we're purchasing them from the...
Yeah, if they're available from, usually we use WB Mason for the bulk of our supplies.
Okay, so this, you know, so I just hope that we're buying those things there instead of someone going to Staples and getting reimbursed. I'm not sure. That didn't seem to make sense to me. In the music budget, Tom, can you talk to us a little bit about the instrument replacement?
Yep, absolutely. As far as the vibraphone is concerned.
I don't even know what that is.
Okay, so a vibraphone is essentially, it's a mallet instrument. It's a xylophone, but it's got metallic bars, and it's more of a jazz instrument. It has a motor that's attached to it. And then it has resonating chambers underneath. So it has the sound of a xylophone, but it's got a wah-wah sound behind it. As far as band literature is concerned, it's one of the holy trinity of mallet instruments. So you have the marimba, which we do have, and then we have the vibraphone, and then ultimately a xylophone. I'm operating with a marimba and a vibe. That being said, the vibraphone that we have currently, when I walked in the door my first day here at Hoosie, it was in pieces, literally, across the floor. Thanks to some really clever work on the part of John Christina, we actually managed to jury-rig it and put it back together, but the motor is absolutely dead at this point. It works intermittently with a lot of WD-40, and unfortunately, because of that, the motor is actually louder than the instrument at this point. So ultimately, that's what I was hoping to replace and hopefully get rid of all the jury-rigged parts. As far as the French horn is concerned, I have 4 French horns at this point. I have 2 French horn players this year. Next year, I'm anticipating I'm going to have actually 5, ultimately, if I'm looking at the numbers correctly. But of those 4 French horns, 2 are in a state of significant disrepair. 1 is absolutely, looks like somebody took and ran it over with a truck. And so I'm hoping to get rid of that one out of my inventory. It's also a single horn instead of a double horn. And so having another double horn in my inventory would be incredibly helpful.
And this is an instrument that typically students do not buy themselves?
Generally, double French horns. We try to start all the younger students on single horns because it's a little bit easier for them to grasp. Adding in the trigger is a step beyond something that's more appropriate to older students.
Okay. Thank you. And then from the art department, the maintenance portion of the Max, how much more life do you think you'll be able to get out of them by doing that?
We have the new Mac Lab, which is working well. We have the old Mac Lab, and they are going on 4 years old. And at this point, it's on a laptop by laptop case. And some are just, matter of fact, one we just, it was dead, it was a brick. So of the 19, 4 are fairly dysfunctional. I don't know if I'm answering your question in terms of dollars, but.
No, I saw the dollars. I'm just wondering if you think that you're gonna get another, you know, 2 or 3 years from them once.
I mean, we've been trudging through, I think, another year.
Okay. My question is more about the ones that we would repair than the new ones.
Right. Of course, we have an Apple Care for our new ones, so that's a little peace of mind for us.
So is that a warranty program with them?
Yes.
Essentially, you walk in the store and hand them the device, and if there's something wrong with it, they just hand you a new device, and you walk out the door. And that's good for current, I think we had a 1-year warranty, so that'll get us through the honeymoon period, so to speak, with these.
I think it's already been used for 1 unit.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yep.
Thank you. Any other questions? Jonathan?
Just to follow up on that, Warren, you have a new lab and an old lab?
That's correct.
How many computers are in the new lab?
20.
And that's for the art folder for the art department?
That's Linda and I share that.
Yeah.
So with 2 labs, I mean, you're using them at the same time?
Yes.
Consistently?
For example, I just sent an email to Ian saying we have, in a given semester, the spring semester, I am teaching computer animation, and the old Macs are there, it's just not working. So I need my computer animation class uses that. Simultaneously, Linda's art of photography classes uses them because Photoshop is a key part of the course. And sculpture. And Linda should elaborate on just how great that is. So at any given time, there's a tremendous demand on the new lab, and the old one is kind of the backup. And I'm using the old one for the computer painting class because the Photoshop, although glitchy, is serviceable, if that explains that.
And I assume the 3D printer is going to impact that usage too?
That's correct.
Through the sculpture class. That's why we're earmarking those for the sculpture class, because they'll need that to use the printer for the modeling software.
Thanks.
Thank you. Any other questions? Okay, thank you very much.
Okay.
what do I have next? I have Paul Padua, you want to?
Sure, tech ed and business ed.
Did anyone have questions? So, Paul, I guess I just have a question.
Sure.
About what photography is being taught out of your department versus what photography is being taught out of the art department?
Currently, this past, let me say this, the first semester here, John and Christina co-taught with the art department photography course, and that was a digital photography course. Prior to that, we had black and white photography, which was probably the best subscribed course that we had going back for 35 years here. We had 2 to 3 classes of black and white photography and an advanced black and white photography. Previous administrator decided that black and white photography didn't need to be taught and didn't need to be in tech ed, and it was taken off the books.
All right, because my question is, it seems like we have a little bit of a duplication here, or I don't know if we need to, I mean, I don't know, but I question whether it needs to be co-taught, and I know nothing about any of it except that when I went to visit art schools with my daughter, black and white photography was a huge component of freshman form and a foundation piece for what they do if you're going to be, you know, for these art students. So my question, I guess, is there any looking at going back to teaching the black and white photography from your department?
We would welcome that with open arms. We would love to teach black and white photography. We were able to talk to the previous administrator into keeping the dark room because it was scheduled to be removed. So the dark room is still in place. We still have the hardware in place as far as enlargers and the other things that go into the dark room. We even have materials still. John is doing a little bit on occasion with some of the freshmen this year, but not like we used to do, and not to the degree that you're talking about the colleges are looking for. We would certainly love to do that again.
Okay, so maybe I can encourage you guys to have a conversation.
Well, what's the thought of, and this is me being ignorant, not being an artist at all, but what's the theory behind having it taught in the technology department rather than in the art department? That's what I'm fuzzy on. Just because of the developing portion of it, the darkroom part?
Historically, going back, and I'm talking going way back, when I first started teaching here in 79, black and white photography was part of what we called at that time industrial arts. There was a shortage of industrial arts teachers, and they brought in an art teacher, and they gave that particular course dual credit, either satisfy the art requirement or the industrial arts requirement. That way they could get away with having the art teacher teaching in what was an industrial arts course. Why it was one over another, I don't know, but historically here at Housatonic, it has been an industrial arts course.
And it's true at a lot of schools that it will either be a tech ed teacher or an art teacher.
So it could be either one.
Right.
And to just sort of further on what Paul said, we have art school admissions people, reps, come to visit us. And on 2 occasions, the reps have said, you have digital and black and white, or traditional film photography and digital. They say, great. They said, that's great. Some schools, you know, had let their black and white traditional film labs go by the wayside. So.
Unfortunately, as far as next school year, because the previous administration had taken black and white photography off of the books, currently does not in the course of study. So when students are asked to enroll in courses for next year, it will not be in their course of study. If the board supports, if the administration supports running that next year as either an art or a tech ed or a dual credit course, we need to somehow get the message out to students when at the time they're enrolling for next year.
Okay. Thank you, Paul. Any other questions? All right. agriculture education. Mark?
Okay. I don't know if anybody have any questions or...
One of my questions was the looking for updates on CDs and DVDs. Does that not fall under the library media? You do your own buying?
We've done both, but we've always included some in our budget for that. It's just what we've done. I think, it offsets some of what the school has to buy because we do generate some income against our budget and that. I don't know if you've seen that yet, mm-hmm. part of it. But that's why we do that.
Okay. Does anyone have any other questions?
Well, I guess I was interested in if you foresee, how do you foresee using the SciTech building?
Ooh. as far as ag is concerned, or as far as the total thing, I think it's evolving, and I think obviously we're using it for electric car business. It looks like robotics is going to use it. I think the eventually the media room will come about. I think if we get some community support with that. And obviously we have Mr. Lindsay over there. He's doing some stuff with the elementary schools too. As far as programs and having things available, sort of like a science library, but it's, if they want a fuel cell car, they can come get it and take it to their school.
But the electric car is presently part of your
program. Yeah, we're doing it as part of ag, but it's pretty much extracurricular right now.
So. I've seen it.
Yeah.
Nice.
Thank you. Any other questions? All right, thank you, Mark.
Okay, thank you.
Scott, for Matt.
Move down into the hot seat.
I did.
Yeah. I have a couple of questions. You have in here batteries for graphing calculators. I'm wondering how many the school actually purchases, because I know that you have a small supply, or I believe a small supply, because most students will buy their own graphing calculator, correct?
Yeah. The batteries are, I think, in that supply line. I'll go with the example that's come up a couple of times tonight, that we buy them when we need them, and if we don't, then that money gets spent on protractors this year or compasses this year. We don't have a lot of graphing calculators of the TI-84, TI-83 family here in the building anymore because kids are buying them.
Right.
But we're sort of transitioning now into the TI-Inspires, which are sort of a more powerful version of the calculators, which will need batteries at some point in their lives. So yeah, kids are buying the 83s and 84s. They're not really buying the Inspires yet. Okay. They're still kind of expensive for them.
Right. Okay. And we talked a little bit, it looked like you were looking for 5 carts of laptops,
yeah,
right?
At least to start with. That's a starting point.
You really want 7.
I really want 10. No, with the transition to the Common Core state standards, there's a huge push in the math standards towards the use of technology across students' learning experiences. So I brought a quote. In the Common Core standards, it says that strategic use of technology is expected in all work. And I think where we are right now with the lab that we have here, it's sometimes difficult for us to schedule students into that lab to be able to use the technology that we have available. And I think if we had it available in the rooms, it would allow for some of that I guess the easiest way to say it is kind of that aha moment to happen. You know, I teach geometry, and often a kid will say, well, is such and such true? Well, we'd like to investigate that, sort of use the Geometry Sketchpad software, some online software, a bunch of things, to investigate those statements that students would make. But we haven't signed up for the computer lab, and there may be another class in there. It may not be the kind of thing that we want to walk down the hallway, take that much time to come down the hallway, do the investigation, go back. Whereas if that stuff were available to students sort of at the ready, we could take 6 or 8 or 10 minutes out of a 45-minute class period and do that. If we're trudging down to the computer lab, that 6 to 8 minutes becomes 12 to 15 minutes and much more difficult to accomplish. So that's sort of where we're headed with that kind of a purchase. That amount that's in the budget would pay for, I budgeted for 25 machines for 5 rooms and the carts, and it shocks me how much the cart itself mm-hmm. costs, by the way. But that's where we're starting.
So I look at your numbers, you know, per class, and I just wondered, I'm thinking a little more long-term than just this year, you know, because if we buy, you know, 125 this year, then I'm assuming we have to replace 125 in 4 or 5 years down the line. So I'm thinking about how we stagger this, but I also wonder, based on the small class size, the highest number of students really is 19 and a half students, if you know, just do the math per class. You know,
yep.
If we had more carts, like 6 carts with 20, you know, and then maybe it's, then we have more carts to go throughout the building to be used in other classroom, you know, other areas of study as well. So I kind of was looking at that, and I'm wondering if that option sounds reasonable to you.
We actually had that conversation at a department meeting mm-hmm. About how many needed to be in the various classrooms, and one of the difficulties with the 19.5 number is that, well, I don't know who the half kid is, but perhaps more importantly, that 19.5 is a result of some classes of A and some classes of B averaging out to 19.5. So for example, the Algebra 2H class this year started the school year and went probably through most of the first marking period with either 26 or 27 students in it to begin with. So even the 25 that might have been in the classroom would have meant that there were students in that class who didn't have a machine when they came to class. And I think that's the difficulty that we have with the scheduling, is that things don't always balance out nicely at whatever the most convenient number is. And I think that's sort of where that 25 number okay. came from.
All right, thank you.
Yep.
Sure, go ahead.
Scott, I think that there was a request for staffing add back. Could you speak about that, please?
I will. The staffing position, and I want to make it clear that it was never intended to put back, I don't know how to say this correctly, but a teaching position, if you will. Like, the expectation isn't that that person is going to come and teach 5 classes. Rather, that position would primarily be devoted to the intervention that we need to start really having available for students, the tier 2 interventions that need to start being available for students. So what we would be looking at is that person probably teaching, well, it depends on how we decide to schedule it. From a position perspective, that position would teach 1 class and have probably 4 sections spread throughout the day of intervention, where they'd be working 1-on-1, 3-on-1, 5-on-1 with groups of students with identified common needs. Those identifications would come from some of the common assessments that we're doing across classes. The kids would then get identified as needing remediation in fill-in-the-blank topic, which would happen from this person during the school day. And Ian or Diane, please correct me if I'm wrong, but the tier one part of the triangle, everything's a triangle these days, the tier one part, no, it's really just a triangle. But you want to do that to me? Thanks a lot. Wow. The tier one should be effective for about 80% of our population. Martha, my numbers are
yes.
okay. So if we suggest that about 20% of the student population probably is going to need some intervention, some tier 2, maybe tier 3 intervention, take a conservative estimate that we're about 400 students. 20% is actually 80 students. divide that by the four sections that this person would have to devote to intervention, and that's 20 kids per class. That's too much for intervention. The intervention sections should be running 7, 8, 9 kids so that the students get the one-on-one, two-on-one, three-on-one kind of help that they need with the stuff that they're struggling with.
Yes. At what point in the student's day would they do this? Would they be out of a class where they would otherwise be getting some material?
I think that we would hope that it would be scheduled so that they're out of their study hall period, because remember that tier two intervention is not supposed to be, for lack of a better phrase, a lifetime sentence for that kid. They're in when they have trouble, and then they're out. And there are very clear entry standards and very clear exit standards so that the student knows when you meet this standard, when you master this material, you go back to your study hall. That's part of the need to have this position available for 4, 5, whatever number of sections that we can accomplish. We actually had a teacher in the department doing it last year. It was one of her teaching sections. She actually was able to work it out so that she was available 2 periods during the week. So it was like, you know, that we have lettered periods. So she was available B and F. And she was working then with students during those 2 periods. That's one section really filled 2 periods. If we had 4 sections of it, that would potentially cover the 8 periods that we have a day, which would allow students, no matter when their study hall is, to be able to access that resource.
How are you meeting those requirements now for intervention?
We're still in the process of developing an SRBI model. Is that fair, Ian?
Yeah, no, that's a very astute question, because we've built these models, we've built these assessments, and we've gotten it to the point where we can identify the students, but then where should we send them?
There's a wall.
Right.
Right.
Okay.
So are you saying that if you have a student in your algebra class that is having issues or doesn't understand something, they won't go to the main classroom teacher for help?
No. In fact, that's not at all what I'm saying. The model would work such that the teacher would work with that student, called tier one, so it's sort of good instruction. It's what teachers do every day of their lives. When a student is struggling, we see them for extra help, we send them to our learning lab to meet with the teacher who's available in there. We get them here before school, after school, during lunch, whenever the kid can have that time available. In the math department in particular, we actually also send kids to others of ourselves. So if I don't happen to be free when the student has study hall, but one of the other teachers does, we send the student to that other teacher so that they're getting that extra help. The tier two is for those students who are needing more remediation even beyond that in order to stay on track with what's happening in the class. So that's where that tier two process would come in. And students who aren't successful in tier two would then get moved to a tier three level. And that's very individualized, Carl. Are you doing okay with SRBI?
Exactly right.
There you go. So those students would then be identified by that tier two intervention person as needing even more remediation, and that would happen then in one-on-one sessions, presumably during these same periods. So there might be periods where that intervention person is actually just working with a single kid to try to bring them up to speed. I have some statistics for you that I looked up over the weekend. We've been giving an assessment to the eighth graders at the end of eighth grade for a couple of years. I have 2 years worth of data. So of the 150-something students that have taken we call it a pre-algebra assessment. Not pre-algebra, but pre-algebra assessment. Of the 150-something students that have taken it, 61% of them do not score 61% of them score 75% or less on that assessment. That assessment is designed to determine whether the students are ready for Algebra 1, whether they have the background skills to put them in an Algebra 1 class. We've artificially set the level for Algebra 1 at 75%, but 60% of the students are scoring 75% or less. So those students are going to need some of this Tier 2 remediation very, very quickly, very early when they get here, because that's not material that's actually taught in Algebra 1 anymore. That stuff is pre-Algebra 1 material. So we have some students that we already need some of those interventions for.
Are teachers routinely available at the end of the day in what I call a professional office period for that kind of help?
Yes.
Or is scheduling a problem on that?
I think that scheduling only becomes a problem when students wait until the morning that they want to stay.
Well, I thought maybe if they were in sports that they would leave before that office hour was available for special help.
Dan's not here, but the...
But that office hour is available.
Is available, absolutely. And Phil, I think the coaches have all been really, really good over the years to say, if you need extra help, you need to go deal with that first and then come to practice.
So the demand would be too great for that particular period to accomplish that, is that right?
I think that it's too great, but it's also a different kind of a need.
Okay.
That is beyond what could happen in, you know, I need to see you for tomorrow after school because I was absent yesterday. This is bigger than that and identified through some common assessments.
So...
Just to
thank you.
Kind of visualize it, I mean, if you have a student who in seventh grade moved around to different houses, there was something going on at home, divorce, what have you, they missed an entire chunk of seventh grade because they were in a different place. The intervention block, trace a while back to get that material and do that remediation. And that's what we're talking about, not a concept that you taught today in Algebra 1 that you just need a little brushing up on.
That's important. It's not about today's work. It's about making sure that you have the foundations going forward for the content.
So I have two questions. One is specific to this pre-algebra situation. So how are the elementary schools reacting to this? I mean, I assume we've gone back to them and said, look, you're not giving us kids who are getting what they need to get.
I wouldn't say that to my colleagues in the elementary schools. I should say this. We send them the data. So for the last 2 years, they've gotten the scores and what the scores are. They can make of that what they need to. I think, Diane, you would agree that the transition to the Common Core is going to help us, I think, in that regard, because there are some, a lot more sort of specific
aligning
standards,
things.
Yeah, that are going to be there.
So the second question is, if 20% of students, if the estimate is that 20% of students are going to require Tier 3 or Tier 2 intervention, what's the estimate for how long those interventions would last? I mean, we're not going to have...
That is determined within the CERBE model. We call it CERBE model. That's already determined that there's only a specific amount of time that a student can stay at Tier 2. And after a certain amount of time, the team has to come together to analyze the data on the student to determine whether there's three things that can happen on a Tier 2 student. Tier 2 student that has met with success based on intervention can go back to Tier 1 without support and just monitoring. They can stay at Tier 2 for another extended period of time with other interventions put in. Or they can determine that with everybody's best efforts, that student still isn't succeeding. They go to Tier 3, which gives them more intensified services for a determined period of time within the model. The other piece is we're required now by state law to have a CERBE model. We have to have Tier 1, Tier 2, and Tier 3 intervention models.
But we have those at the elementary schools.
Yes, we do.
So how does it get this far? How do these problems get this far up to the high school if we have it at the elementary school?
There's a variety of reasons. First of all, the content becomes more difficult for the student. You heard Karen Prince talk about they're not coming with some of the study skills we need. And very honestly, they come from very small schools where they're very sheltered. They are. The teachers bring them along, they're supported, all of that. They get into a larger environment in which the content's difficult, they're in larger class sizes, they're required to function at a more independent level. So we begin to see that gap a little bit in their ability to acquire knowledge, sustain it, and apply it at levels all the way through how the course is going. The courses are scaffolded to get more difficult as they go along, and we see that gap. And it doesn't mean if the student gets an intervention, it doesn't mean that as the content gets more difficult, the student is still going to continue to struggle.
I'm going to redirect this back to budget, if I can. I'm enjoying getting this information, but I think I have to get the budget impact piece of that because we're going to run out of time and keep people over. So I have one more question, Phil. I'm assuming that the meeting the interventions
needs to happen during the actual school day. Is there some?
Correct.
Okay, so that, okay, thank you. And Phil?
Well, I don't want to go too far afield here, but do you think meeting every student every day would be of some assistance with this problem? Because I'm aware of the fact the way you're presently scheduled, you have quite a bit of distance from.
What do you mean if they're scheduling this different?
Yeah, and in terms of seeing the student, there are also blocks of time when you don't see the student. And can you do yes or no on that or not? Too complicated?
Yeah, too complicated. You know, okay. I can't ever do yes or no, Phil.
Okay.
So I'll say no, because I think Carl and Martha would agree that regardless of how often you see the student, there are going to be students who, I mean, that whole model is built on that tier one intervention is going to get 80% of the kids there, and there are going to be students who need more than that,
okay,
regardless of how often you see them.
All right.
Thank you. Any other questions for Scott? Okay, thank you, Scott.
Thank you.
Beth? Well, I know she presented the budget for us.
Under her,
okay. So. Yeah. Okay, all right. I guess they would like to move on.
Okay.
Thank you. Damon?
Also, answer questions for the Social Studies Department.
Thank you.
Perhaps poorly.
Most of my questions are around the Chromebooks because I don't know anything about them.
Sure.
And I don't know what it is that they will do for you.
Okay, I'm going to try to avoid too much redundancy in saying an awful lot of what you just heard from Scott, but I think math and English are in particularly interesting places because we are the areas that the Common Core prescribes. We're also the areas that the SBAC assesses. So the rationale of the Chromebooks was pretty simple. The Common Core is looking for instruction in English language arts to integrate technology, I think, in a way that hasn't been done before. To borrow Scott's model, it's not a question anymore of trying to purely design assessments that require students to make use of technology to demonstrate learning. It's rather to use that technology regularly in the classroom as an avenue to new learning. So it's the difference between we're going to go down to the computer lab once every 2 weeks versus we're going to be going online multiple times over the course of any given week. There hasn't really been any discussion at this point about that. The elephant in the room, that assessment, the SBAC, which is an online assessment, which does require, I would think, some practice. It's a test that's given once a year. It's a tremendously important test. Curricularly, we have tried as a department to get students ready for that in advance so that the first time they're taking it isn't the first time they're taking it. Currently, in the 9th and 10th grade curriculum, we have 4 practice SBAC assessments. One to be done at some point during the first semester, one to be done at some point during the second semester, and then once as a mid-year and a final. So that is in grade 9 for administrations and in grade 10 for administrations of a practice SBAC that we built and that we did our best to give students this year online using what we had available for technology. And it was really, really difficult. Because there's really only so much leeway in terms of when you can give those practice assessments if you haven't actually taught the skills associated with it and rehearsed them. So we're looking at, in that case, 200 students 4 times over the course of the year who are going to be looking to take a model assessment that takes about 3 hours to administer, so a minimum of 3 class periods. And we're trying to do that in a few computer labs of 20 or 25 machines. So our concern there is blocking out available technology to practically everybody else in the times that we need to do that. But I think more important for us was that instructional piece that they need to see this as kind of part of their everyday learning, not something purely for assessment.
So can they do that on the Chromebooks?
Yes, absolutely. There was the original statement.
Do you have any in the building?
Yes, we do.
I want to see one.
Yeah.
I mean, maybe not today, but I think because I just have no idea what.
There's a social studies classroom that has a set of Chromebooks. And I should point out that the Chromebook compatibility with the SBAC is a change. The original iteration of the SBAC, if you will, was actually really limited in terms of which platforms it supported. But if you go to their webpage today, for the 14-15 administration, so beginning this year, as long as it's Chromebooks running OS 19, the most recent version, they will. And I'm not a Chromebook spokesperson, so please don't mistake me for one, but there's actually an advantage, I personally feel, to administering the test on Chromebooks than on other devices. With any other platform, if you're doing it with a Windows device, if you're doing it with a Mac device, it's necessary that you download a dedicated browser, a secure browser that basically deactivates or takes out the ability for students to go anywhere else during the assessment. With Chrome, you don't have to download that dedicated browser. They've actually worked with the Chrome folks so that they log in and those things are automatically deactivated. That's important for us because teachers in this building aren't in a position to download a browser and install it on any computer in the building that they want to. From a network security standpoint, that's considered a bad thing.
Does anybody have any other?
Just one other. On the additional position that's being requested for English, is that again for remediation intervention possibilities that are going to show up under Common Core?
I think that the bulk of the position at this point probably should be. That's not to suggest that there's not, I think it depends on how, frankly, the principal wants to staff the building. Is there some room potentially for you to have one section or two sections of instruction in English? Sure, right now you have one section above five teachers, so we're already in that situation. I think more compelling is the fact that we've made a commitment to SRVI. We have said beginning next year we're going to implement Tier 2 and Tier 3. We've designed, or we've very nearly designed, a complete model for it. And to Scott's point, you know, we're looking at that 20% of our population, at least 80 students who are going to need that. If you divide that up among three or four sections of English, that's a really healthy population of students working with that person for anywhere from 8 to 20 weeks.
Anybody else have any questions? All right. Can we get all the
social studies?
Chromebooks was social
studies
and
English.
That was
social studies as well. Okay,
yeah, that was both departments. I guess my only other question is the China trip now an annual trip?
That was not part of Peter's prepared comments, so I asked him that more than a year.
Oh, okay.
So I do have one more question.
Sure.
Before you guys, we're talking about social studies, I forgot. So the additional position in social studies? No, there isn't one?
Peter asked me to defer to Ian on that and said that he could provide you an answer. And that
okay.
It was not what it was thought to be. How's that?
So the additional position in social studies is not what it was thought to be, and Pete said to defer to you.
Right, it's a 0.1, actually, in addition to what we have right now. And there was, it mostly, Sam might be able to speak to this a little bit, just because there was some, with Dan Carroll's departure,
right.
We retained that 0.4. So it's between
Sam
the
has
shifting around there. I'm not too sure exactly how it works, to be honest with you.
But, on the budget, as I mentioned in our first workshop, Dan Carroll previously was 0.4, social studies, 0.6, athletic director. The 0.4 is still in the budget. So from a budget to budget standpoint, it's there's no change.
Oh, okay, so no change in social studies and staffing.
Correct.
Okay. All right. Okay. Any other questions for any of the board chairs? We have like a minute and a half. I'm sorry, what did I say?
You said board chairs.
I mean department chairs. I can give this job away. All right, then hearing none, I would just thank you all for coming. It's really appreciated that you gave up your evening to come speak to us. I think we got a lot of information and it will be helpful as we move forward. It's not to say we won't have more questions, but it got us started, so thank you. Is there any other public comment on the budget items? All right, hearing none, I'm looking for a motion to adjourn this meeting.
I'll make that motion.
Second. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? All right, meeting adjourned. Give us 30 seconds to get